Please subscribe and don't forget to press the bell icon to get notified whenever we upload a new video.
Welcome back. Orient Cement is in focus after the company signs an MoU with the Telangana government to expand its Adilabad unit capacity to 8 million tons from 5 million tons at an estimated investment of 2,000 crore rupees. We're now joined by Deepak Khetrapal, the managing director and the CEO of Orient Cement. Deepak, congratulations and thanks for joining us on CNBCTV18. How are you planning to fund this 2,000 crore of an investment?
Look, we have to, I think, take steps one at a time. We've just got the limestone security assured by the Telangana government to our expansion plan. And we are seeking the environment clearances for this expansion work, which will take, I think, the entire balance of this financial year, maybe a couple of months more also. And in the meantime, we are also scheduling how the investments will actually take place. The current expectation is the construction work will begin sometime in FY20, not in FY19 at all. And when you start construction work, the cost outflow is in a phased manner. And as on this date, to suddenly to say that how will you raise 2,000 crores, I think a little too premature. By the time we start construction activity, placing orders, we'll figure out how our balance sheet looks at that time, how our cash flows go during this year. And based on that, we'll take a final call as to what is the best funding structure. At this stage, straight away answering a question, how are you going to fund it, is a little too early. Just wait for a couple of quarters, we'll tell you more.
Yeah, right. So, Mr. Khetrapal, you're telling us that work on this site will start in FY20. So that should be in the first quarter of FY20 is when we assume that work starts. So this entire site, it starts flowing into your numbers only in FY22, FY23, right?
FY20, if we complete the construction, that FY21 certainly will start expecting the revenues and the profits to start flowing from there. Yes, certainly. So, but not in FY20, because FY20 will be... Yeah.
So it'll be 18 to 24
FY20
months?
FY20 will go into the... No. The construction work should not take us more than 15 months, although we'll target in 12 months, but not more than 15 months.
Okay, all right. Give us a sense of what's your balance sheet looking like. I'm just looking at it. You've paid, you've been paying back your debt slowly. Your finance cost was lower for the last quarter. Even in the last fiscal, it was lower. So clearly, the money that you're generating, you're using it to at least repay some of your debts. What's the current debt in your books? And
that's right.
If you could give us a rough borrowing cost.
The total cost is about, borrowing as of now is about 1,200 crores, including the loan that we had taken for the project and short-term working capital requirements.
Okay.
And we obviously don't disclose the exact terms of borrowing from the banks, but it's very, very competitive. That all I can say is it's well below 9%. More than that, I think, would be laying too much information out in the public.
Any incentives that the government is offering you all?
No, they have a very strong, very attractive industrial policy in the state, and we will be getting the benefits for new investments. But more than the pure financial incentives, what we're very enthused about expanding in Telangana state is the overall support that the government is extending to us in terms of whatever we need to do to make sure that the project succeeds. So financial incentives are there for everyone. And almost every state has an industrial policy under which they invite investments.
Mm.
But this one is more exciting because of all-round support that the government of Telangana has assured us of.
Okay. By the end of this year, will you all be looking to repay some debt, Mr. Khetrapal? And also, you would have had a look at the site, right? You're telling us that it's going to go from 5 to 8 million. At most, what can this site, does it have capacity to even expand from that 8 million?
Yes, it has. The site has enough, land available. It has enough limestones all around it. Nigel, as you would know, that limestone is just one of the factors.
Yeah.
We'll also need to factor in what's the size of the market, how much can it absorb from one location. So all those factors will kick in besides the limestone. But answering your question, does it have enough resources there to expand further? Yes, it has.
Okay. And just as we wrap the discussion, if you could give us a sense of how the prices are trending currently in the south and the west region.
Well, pricing currently, as all of us do know, during the monsoon period, the prices do remain a little soft, and that's how volumes and prices both are soft currently. I would say, how do they compare with the same period in the earlier years? I think the track of growth that we've seen is very much intact. But compared to the non-monsoon quarters, obviously these are softer quarters.
Okay, quick question, Mr. Khetrapal, on your operational performance. We didn't have you when your results came out, but what's the mix currently in terms of pet coke and coal? And your EBITDA per ton, if I do a rough calculation, is at around 530 rupees. So that's a sharp expansion if I look at it on a sequential basis. Give us a guidance of the EBITDA per ton. What can we work with?
Well, I still maintain that our targets are and should always be in EBITDA per ton of more than 800 rupees a ton. In the first quarter, if you came out lower than that, largely to do with two factors, as I explained. One is, in any case, the prices remain much softer compared to what we needed them to be, given the large cost increases. And secondly, I think we were also hit by the sudden pressure on availability of domestic coal from our coal suppliers. And we had to switch our fuel source to imported coal, which actually put a lot of pressure on the cost. So that's what cut into our plans. But as those things normalize, we should start looking back to EBITDA of 800 rupees or thereabouts. That's the right level of EBITDA for our company where we are.
Okay.
All right. We'll leave it at that. Thank you very much for joining in. By the way, pharma stocks are making up move ahead of numbers today.
Yes, we have a few winners for you on the screen. But if you're looking at losers, then IRB Infra has slipped in the last few minutes. So I think we should pull up the intraday chart of that stock. I don't know whether there's some news flow. But from the day stop, it's corrected close to around 2%. Suddenly, that stock is moving lower. And even REC, now the stock is down close to around 3%. And profit booking is what we're seeing on that counter. But how do you trade the Nifty? Well, things are looking up, actually. We spoke to Ashwini earlier today when the markets were at around 11,400. And it's already given you close to around 40 points from there. Ashwini, what would the trade be? What are the levels you're looking at if someone followed that advice and had a long position?
See, today what is different about Bank Nifty is that both retail and corporate banks are moving up. So that way, you know, the momentum is very high. And I would think even if you have bought earlier and if you decide to buy now, there's a good chance that markets could close at the highs of the day and a second leg of the move can start from here. So that way, still positive on Bank Nifty as well as Nifty. In fact, today, after many days of correction, retail banks are coming back. So Kotak Mahindra is a buy with a stop of 1286, target of 1340. RBL Bank is a buy with a stop of 565, target of 590. And HDFC Bank is a buy with a stop of 2125, target of 2180.
Okay. Let's get in Sandeep Wagle into the discussion as well. Sandeep, your trading ideas?
Afternoon. I would go with a buy in Ashok Leyland, stop loss of 122, target of 133. And a buy in a Torrent Pharma, stop loss of 1683, target 1755.
Okay, all right. Thanks so much for that, Ashwini, as well as Sandeep, for joining in and filling us in with those details. Well, I think we have the European markets that are opening, so let's get the initial rates up for you. Remember, yesterday was a good session, actually. All those markets, they ended with good gains. We had a couple of earnings reactions, and they look good. And on the back of that, those markets looked pretty good. For starters, that DAX rate, I'll be looking at it closely. It's looking like it's a relative outperformance as we speak, because that market's holding with a gain of around 0.4%. These are initial rates that we're getting in. So we'll tune in a few minutes again, and we'll just see once those markets settled out. Otherwise, both those two, most of the markets are flattish. Actually, the DAX, yeah, now we're getting a more realistic rate. The DAX, all those markets, they're more or less flattish as we speak, with a bit of a negative bias after the good run that we saw in yesterday's trading session.
Let's move on then to a mega CNBC TV18 exclusive. CNBC TV18, Shireen Bhan traveled and to the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation to catch up with Bill Gates himself, the co-founder of Microsoft and the co-chairman of Gates Foundation. Listen in to his views on the ongoing global trade war.
We're in the midst of tariffs and retaliatory tariffs, with the US imposing tariffs, China responding, the EU's in on it as well, including India. How do you see the global economy today? As we look at political leaders who are perhaps looking more inwards than outwards, what is the impact likely to be on global trade?
Well, the global economy actually is doing quite well right now. The estimates have actually been pushed up a little bit. U.S. growth, China growth, India growth. You know, those are It's rare that those are all going fairly well. Mm. Certainly, these trade issues are scary in that if you get people turning inwards, raising up tariffs, the global economy is not going to do as well. There's huge benefits to trade. You know, take if one country's growing too much of a crop, the fact that you can, you know, send it, say, to Africa where it's needed. Mm. Otherwise, when you get a bumper crop, then you get a price collapse because you don't have that global demand. And so agriculture has been an area where a number of countries, including India, you know, had to think, okay, how willing are they to be a part of that global trading system?
Mm-hmm. So, you know, we're not in the midst of a full-blown trade war just yet. What do you believe is likely to be the tipping point?
Well, I don't have a crystal ball on this, but the rhetoric that, okay, you know, we'll use trade tariffs and we'll force somebody to do something, that can escalate. Mm. And so, you know, we could end up with a lot of tariffs and all the plans people have made about assuming their global supply chains will work and that they're able to do exports and imports. You know, that alone will be quite a burden on economic growth and therefore for job creation. Mm-hmm. And in all of these things, you always have to say, okay, the poorest countries, you know, they're the ones who are just barely getting by. Mm-hmm. And so it's always interesting to think, you know, how do we avoid them suffering? You know, even Indian farmers want, you know, their crops to be exportable.
With our stock-specific approach, earlier today we got chatting with Praj Industries. They had reported a muted set of numbers. Shishir Joshipura, the MD and CEO of the company, told us that several segments of the company's business are seeing tailwinds. Listen in.
We are seeing at the back of both in India as well as outside India, policy interventions on ethanol blending mandates across the countries on picking up of alternative technologies, driving higher energy efficiencies in the plants, even for other businesses like zero liquid discharge systems, our CPES business, pharma business, we are seeing good tailwinds in several segments of our businesses, and I'm very sure that this will translate into a positive result as we go forward.
Okay, all right, let's get to our next company. We have another cement company, Sanghi Industries. That's the next stock on our radar. Remember the numbers, quarter one numbers looked rather weak, actually. Some part of the street was expecting a bit of a bounce back, and that's why in yesterday's trading session, the stock was under some pressure. But to discuss what went on in the past quarter and what's the way going ahead, we have Ms. Bina Engineer, the director of the company, who joins us to run us through all those details. Hi, ma'am. Thanks so much for joining in. Give us some basic details. What went wrong in this past quarter? What was the sales volumes? What is your targeted sales volumes going ahead? And also, what was your EBITDA per ton?
Yeah, so we continue to maintain our annual targets at about 3.2 million. We have achieved around 3.3% growth in domestic sales market and around 1.5% growth on the overall volume. So we have achieved about 680,000 tons of volume, which is about 66-67% of our overall utilization in terms of the capacity. There were two, three constraints that we faced during this period. Was one was on account of the severe restriction on the logistic activities in the region because of the overloading vigilance taken up by the RTO in Kutch region, and therefore the availability of the trucks in that region was affected during the quarter. Subsequent to the change in auto policy, the axle load has increased, and therefore that has enabled us to restore the truck availability, and therefore the dispatches have improved since then. That was one factor. Second factor was that we had also reduced availability of fly ash during this period because of the underutilization of the ultra mega power plant in Kutch region. And therefore, the availability of fly ash and the corresponding drop in volume of PPC or blended cement also affected the volume as well as the EBITDA margin.
Okay.
Third major factor was fuel and power. where we had reduced availability of lignite from the Kutch region because of the water logging that had occurred in the Surat region mines of GMDC, and there was shift of customers from that region to Kutch region that reduced availability for us. So we had to buy coal at a higher price. So all these three factors had significant impact on the performance during the last quarter.
Okay. Ms. Engineer, good afternoon and thanks so much for joining in. So given these headwinds and only a 1.5% sales volume growth in Q1, is it likely that your full year volume growth is likely to be closer to the lower end of your guidance, which is at 3 million tons, rather than the upper end, which is at 3.2 million ton, which implies a 10% growth?
Yes, I still maintain the same range of 3 to 3.2 million for the year as a whole.
Okay.
Because we anticipate a significant growth to come in the second half of the year. So volume-wise, we would still maintain that.
No, and, I was asking,
Gujarat is still,
will your actual volumes be closer to the lower end or upper end?
Will it be 3.2 or 3
million? Yeah, since I mean, I would still maintain that range rather than falling on one end of the range. I would still maintain the range. We should let's wait for a couple of more quarters to have a more accurate estimate.
Okay, all right. You know, Ms. Engineer, if you could give us your sales breakup. I think you were making a point in terms of Gujarat, right? So how much are you selling in Gujarat? I remember you were telling us that you're looking to penetrate even into the Mumbai market. So how much is in Gujarat? How much is in Maharashtra? And in Maharashtra, how much is in Mumbai?
So Gujarat is about 80%, which was earlier 85%. So
correct.
Gujarat as a component has reduced.
Okay.
Maharashtra is, for us, Maharashtra is Mumbai.
Hmm.
And Mumbai has increased from about 4-5% to 10%.
Okay.
And it will continue to grow during the rest of the year with, because of our ship commissioning and the coastal shipping activity and penetration in Mumbai market.
Okay.
So going forward, Gujarat will, for this year, we would estimate Gujarat to remain between 75-80% and Mumbai between 10-14%.
Okay. So since predominantly you are in the Gujarat region, has the low offtake from the UMPP stabilized now, which impacted you in Q1?
So, yes, there is improvement in utilization of the mega power plants in Kutch, and therefore the availability of fly ash is expected to improve in next couple of months.
Okay. All right. Ma'am, you know, you're saying that y'all are penetrating to the Mumbai market. Is it coming at the cost of realizations? Because I'm aware that a couple of these large players, they're undercutting the market. Now, there is some price cuts that we are seeing. Are you seeing any kind of pricing pressure?
We move along the market, but typically in Mumbai, we are a new player. So we are what is called B-plus pricing and not A pricing, which is, say, for the top national brand. But we are pricing ourselves far better B-plus than the rest of the market or rest of the brand.
Okay. And your fuel and power mix, what is it? You said that, you know, there was flooding at GMDC. So that's why there was, you know, you have changed your mix. So what is it currently? Lignite was 70-75%, I remember, more than that as well. Earlier.
Correct. Yeah. In June 17, lignite was 83%, which came down to around 23% in June 18 quarter. Ooh.
Oh.
So there was a complete reversal of the mix because of the lignite shortage.
And now it is all okay?
Which we expect that by September, October, GMDC has assured that the lignite quota should be restored to the old levels and therefore there should be better availability of lignite.
So currently you're using pet coke and coal? Out on PVR, now that stock has come off actually the high point of the day. You pull up the intraday chart, that'll tell you the picture. In fact, the Bombay High Court is hearing the multiplex case, and now that has been shifted to the 3rd of September. Yash Jain is celebrating his birthday out there. Hey Yash, happy birthday first of all, and fill us in with all the court action.
Well, Nigel, thank you so much. As far as the court action is concerned, you know, so far in this particular case, there were two parties, right? The one party which was the petitioner, the PIL petitioner, they were arguing for essentially allowing moviegoers to carry own food inside multiplex. And on the other hand, there were multiplex associations who were really, you know, praying that that particular restriction should not be lifted and outside food should not be allowed. Now, today, as far as the hearing is concerned, a third front has really opened in the form of the government council. You know, the Maharashtra Food and Beverage Minister had made a statement in the parliament saying that food, outside food should be allowed. But today, sort of a U-turn on that particular case, the government council has sort of taken side with the multiplex association, has said that outside food should not be allowed inside multiplex because that would create a lot of security concerns. Also, he said that it's a private property at the end of the day, and the license agreement is with the multiplex owner, and it's up to him to decide the policies of the agreement of the license. Also, opening the third front, he essentially said that, you know, a discussion can be done as far as the prices of the food and beverage segment is concerned, and that is something where a control could be brought. But taking a very clear stand on the main issue, the government really saying that outside food should not be allowed as far as multiplex is concerned. So really, we'll have to wait now till September 3rd as far as more clarity is concerned. At that time, the petitioner, which is the PIL petitioner, will be filing a rejoinder, a reply to what the government has stated in the court today.
All right, Yash, thank you very much for that. Go catch yourself, go catch a movie on your birthday today.
Yeah, with multiple dates.
At a multiplex. Thanks, Yash, for that. So that seems to be the government leaning that perhaps, you know, outside food may not be allowed, but they could look at regulating the food and beverage pricing. The stocks have recovered a tad bit from the lows now. On to Manisha Gupta then, who's going to give us a complete roundup of all the commodity and the currency market action. Hi, Manisha.
Hi, thank you so much. Since we are talking food, should talk about the sugar prices first of all, and they have been getting cheaper actually. The last 2 weeks, we've seen constant decline come in for prices. Remember, the government has been fixing mill-wise quota now on how much the mills should be selling per month. So we saw a number for the month of July. August, of course, has been slightly on the higher side in sense of sales. That is because the markets will start looking at the festivity sugar buying as well. And that perhaps is expected to support the prices. But that hasn't been the case because the bulk buying is still absent. You also are looking at very high production, strong stocks lying around with the markets, stockists, etc. And that continues to weigh onto the markets. As I said, 1.75 million tons in the month of August versus 1.65 for July. And that 1.75 is also going to be higher because add to that the kind of sugar quota from the mills who have actually exported 4 lakh tons out of the country. So there is more sugar for the month of August. The buying is not yet started and that weighs on the prices. Sumit Bagaria now joins us to talk more about that space and more. Sumit, hi. First of all, let's do sugar itself. What is your sense on the prices and demand there?
Hi, Manisha. Good afternoon. Well, see, there is a possibility that we might see some dip in the prices from present levels. I think there is a possibility that from here on, we can see a fall of around 2% or 3%. So it's better to be on short side in sugar instead of taking a long position.
Short on sugar, but are you going long on metals? Because today seems to be like kind of day where there is short covering, bargain buying. The dollar has been supportive. So have been the Chinese policies.
Oh, well, yes, I think most of the commodities are giving a pullback move. So precious metals and base metals are looking good to me. I think as far as base metals are concerned, one can initiate long positions in lead at the current market price, with a stop loss to be placed at 146 levels on lower side for the upside target of 151 and 153 levels.
Sumit, also come in on the gold and silver side, as you mentioned, because we have seen some buying come in there. You know, we've been making lower lows. We've seen a 14-month low in case of gold, 1,204 and back now. How strong support levels do you see at 1,204, 1,200, 1,180 is what the markets are talking about for the very near term, though?
See, immediately there is a possibility that we might see a pullback move in gold because it's oversold on charts. And in last couple of weeks, what we have seen is that it has given a sharp sell-off. And from the levels of $1,300, it has given a one-way correction. Now, immediately, it has psychological support at around $1,200. So there is a possibility that we might see a pullback or bounce-back move in COMEX gold from present levels. I think immediately from here on, we can see a move till $1,230 or $1,235. If the price are able to sustain above $1,235, then only we will see a good upside move. Otherwise, we will again see selling pressure at higher levels. So immediately, for a trading perspective, one can initiate long positions in gold and silver at the current market price. I think out of gold and silver, one can pick silver as a trading bet. One can initiate long positions at 37,900, 38,000 levels,
okay,
with a stop loss to be placed at 37,700 levels on lower side for the upside target of 38,300 and 38,500 levels.
And quickly, before we let you go, what's your sense now on the crude oil prices?
There is a possibility that we might see some more correction in crude prices from present levels. So for a trading perspective, for next 2 to 3 days' time horizon, one can initiate sell positions in crude August contract at 4750, 4770 levels, with a small stop loss to be placed at 4810 on higher side for the downside target of 4680 and 4650 levels.
Okay.
Immediately, the range for crude is placed between 4600 on lower side to 4810 on higher side.
Okay, all right. Thanks so much, Sumit, as well as Manisha, for joining in and filling us in with this commodity strategies. But we have run out of time on Halftime Report. As we do that, we'll leave you with an exclusive chat that Lata Venkatesh had with Mr. Sanjeev Goenka, the head of the group, in fact. Let's hear out about that conversation.
FMCG has been on my mind for a very long time, and we started working on it a long time ago. The origins came from a study that McKinsey did.
Okay.
And they said you either get into IT-enabled services or FMCG. That's when we got into First Source.
Okay.
Since then, FMCG has been pretty much on our mind, and we've been working on products. And we've been waiting for the right time to launch. It's very encouraging to see that in the first 12 months, we today are at a 500 crore beat rate, and we're going at about 22 to 23% every month. So it's a very encouraging response. The products have been exceptionally well received. And I'll share with you something that happened last week.
Mm-hmm.
And there was a transport strike, and
yes,
so supplies were impacted. So this distributor came to our people and said that, what's happening, you're not giving us supplies. So they said, out of our 30 SKUs, we only have two. This distributor was taking about 25 lakhs regularly. He said, chalo humko 25 lakh ke do hi product de do.
Okay, so desperate.
So desperate. So that's the first real strong sign of a consumer pull.
Absolutely. No, I mean, 500 crore, I didn't even expect you to tell me a number as big as this. And 23-24% growth CAGR. Yeah, month to month. I mean, that's a huge growth. And it's not a small base now, when you're speaking about 500 crore. So, you know, what's your future plan? Will you bring it to the market? I mean, when I say market, I mean stock market. At what time do we see, you know,
not immediately, but you will see it. I mean, the holding company will, of course, be listed. Okay. This will be
this
part
is Ventures?
Of this is CSC Ventures, but this company will also get listed at some stage, but at a much later stage. Once it's a lot bigger, we have many more plans.
Okay.
So far, it's only been guilt-free snacks, but you will see other categories coming in. Work is on at a frantic pace.
Okay.
We are already out to, I think, 390,000 distribution outlets, which is like a phenomenal ramp up, actually.
That covers the entire country?
That covers the entire country. But we have to get to, we have to double this number in the next 12 months.
Okay.
And
okay,
fingers crossed.
Sure, of course. You know, what's the timetable for listing CESC Ventures itself?
Well, we've got the NCLT clearance. We are awaiting a clearance from the State Regulatory Commission, which hopefully should come soon. So as soon as that comes, we'll apply to SEBI for listing.
So maybe, what, a couple of months away?
I hope.
Okay. No, I mean, otherwise your entire demerger plan and listing plan is over.
Absolutely.
This is the last of
this
the block.
This is the last, yes.
What may be the you know, size you are looking for your FMCG business, for your snacking business? How much is it already? I believe you have products even other than 2Yum. So what is the total size of that FMCG piece?
Well, FMCG today is at a beat rate of about 500 crores.
Okay.
I think in the next 5 to 6 years, our target is 10,000 crores.
Okay. 10,000, okay. So
yes,
you expect
absolutely
to go 20 times
absolutely
in 5 years?
Absolutely.
Okay. So you list only at that time?
No, we list somewhere in between.